Well, we'll use the formal communication method.
Let's.
Let's start.
Let's put you present, then you can go right back.
Present?
Okay, are you ready? Okay. Meeting of the Charter Review Commission is called to order. Roll call, please.
Here.
Mr. McKenzie? Mr. Metcalf?
Here.
Ms. McGee?
Here.
Mr. Richardson?
Here.
Ms. Wessel?
Here.
Here.
Okay, do you have a quorum? Okay, we do have a quorum. And Commissioner Richardson, would you give us the pledge of allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You have the agenda before you. There is one item I'd like to add to the agenda under reports. Number four would be a report on the Ford proposal.
A report on?
The Ford proposal.
Ford School.
Yeah, mm-hmm. School.
Ford School proposal.
Ford School.
Thank you. Okay. You did receive the minutes and if there is no question regarding the minutes, I'd like the minutes to be accepted for the record.
Okay. No objection.
All right, thank you. We do have a special presentation, and we have a guest with us tonight, Mr. John West, who is one of the former 1974 commissioners. And we'd like to bring him forward at this time. Mr. West.
When I received your letter, you indicated that you wanted some discussion about the process that we used as we developed the charter. I did take the time to go to the website and read the minutes that were available, and you seem to be proceeding through the same steps that we went through in that you elected officers. You designed a committee structure that looks a whole lot like the one that we utilized. The one thing that I would emphasize out of the three committees that you put together is the citizen and political, or the citizen input committee is going to be most important to you, I think, in the end. And keeping the electorate informed is going to be critical. When we met, we early on laid out a schedule of what we were going to review and what topics we were going to talk about. Apparently, unlike you, we had a consultant who actually worked with us and gave us a questionnaire of 90 topics that we were to rate as to importance in the review process. And then based on the results of his study, we worked our way through most of the topics that are covered in the charter. There was one exception to that. At the very front end of the process, we had the added advantage of a broad form consensus that we should get rid of the city manager form, the strong city manager form of government, and go to a strong mayor. We voted early on to make it clear that all of us were looking toward getting a strong mayor. which was the major issue that had driven the charter revision process being put on the ballot in the first place. I would just, while we're on this topic, I just can't resist throwing in a cautionary note here. I've heard all this talk about converting back to a professional city manager form of government. What I would warn you about with that is go back and read a little history about what was going on back in 1970, 71, 72, and 73 when we had a city manager form of government. There wasn't a lot of consensus in the city, and the council was often divided 5-4, and we went through a number of city managers in a very short period of time. Obviously, city managers can work. It works in other communities, but I'm telling you that back then, it had become really chaotic. And in fact, just to emphasize the point in the middle of our process, Brian Rapp, the city manager, and Frank Patitucci resigned in the middle of the charter revision process. And we ended up with another city manager. And I believe Mr. Bogan took over at that point. In terms of the actual process, we worked our way through the priorities. And as we addressed each priority, it was agreed in our rules that there would be three readings of whatever language we came up with. That gave everybody ample opportunity to review it, comment on it, share it with people, get feedback from other people in the community, wait for community response to what was being proposed, so if we were stepping in something, we'd find out about it in a hurry. That happened on more than one occasion, and I think it's critical that you have a process at least similar to that, if that's not the one you've already adopted in your rules. That stops, I mean, just another thought that occurs to me as I'm saying this, is it's important that you pick off three or four major topics that you're going to amend, if that's what you're going to do, and stay away from controversial topics. It's going to be very hard to get the public to vote for whatever you come up with anyway. And if you do something really controversial that angers one of the parties feels aggrieved by what you've done, it's not going to take a lot of effort on anybody's part to get people to vote no. We experienced that with one of the pressure groups. We went out of our way to try to make them happy. And in the end, there was a bit of a, almost, I don't want to use the word double cross because it's pretty strong language, but we thought we had put out the final fire, and then just as the charter went on the ballot, they formed an anti-charter coalition and actually worked against the charter. In another couple of instances, we did something that it turned out the public really wasn't all that crazy about. It escapes me what the topic was at the time. But after getting feedback from a number of the key actors in the community, we had to back off and decided not to put that in the charter. You're trying to build broad form consensus to make this thing work. If you can't get to consensus, you're going to have a real problem trying to get adopted whatever you write. But that three readings process helps you ferret out that input from the community, and it allows you time to review and read and contemplate what you're proposing. One other note about the three readings thing, Tom can maybe help me with this, but I think right at the end to make sure, I mean, one of the things that goes wrong with the three readings process is if on reading two you make an amendment, does that now become reading one and you got to start the clock over again and do it? What we finally did to make sure there wouldn't be any legal questions about it right at the end of our process is I believe there were three formal readings of the entire document right at the end to make it clear that we had met the requirement of having three formal readings of all of the language. The other thing that we did along the way with all of this, we had access to a number of consultants who were able to help us. And I realize you people have a restricted budget, but I would ask you to continue to push and prod to get some kind of money in order to get some consulting help. They were of tremendous help to us. They drafted language for us, for instance. Once we made our decision on what we wanted to do with a particular topic, Tom Donilon and some other attorneys that we retained actually wrote the language up and brought it back to us for review. Other consultants, as I indicated, to help us come to consensus. We had another consultant who, for lack of a better phrase, gave us a basic civics lesson in how cities and municipalities were organized in the state of Michigan and what our options were. Also, at some point, your language is, unless the Home Rule Act changed in between when we did this, the governor's office has to technically review and approve of the language and comment on it. When we got very close to realizing that we were almost done, rather than wait till the very end, we submitted large amounts of the language to the governor's office early so that they could start their review process, which in turn sped the process of being able to put it on the ballot. That's the other thing I would comment on. We made the commitment to get done within a year and get it on the ballot, and I don't know if we quite met it. At one point, we ended up delaying our original target date. But the advantage of that is all the information's right there, right now, and in front of everybody. And the longer you draw out the process, the more likelihood that you're going to run into opposition that's going to have additional time to just make your life into misery. So I believe in that compact schedule in getting the whatever you develop done in a timely manner and on the ballot in a timely manner. Let's see. Public education. We began each of our sessions, like you have here today, allowing anybody that wanted input to speak. Joe Conroy headed up that committee, and Joe, for a number of reasons, not the least of which was he was running for office that year, made sure that plenty of political people ended up in front of us. We had all of the former mayors that were alive come in at one time or another. I know we had the congressman come in. We had representatives from the UAW Cap Council. The AFSCME people came in to speak to us. Ex-councilmen came in, current councilmen came in. Joe Citizens came in. At almost every meeting, we had 15 to 20 minutes of presentation by somebody. Beyond that, we also set up an advisory committee that we had meet on weekends so that people who worked during the week would be free to come. And those advisory committee meetings, so we had each charter commissioner was allowed to select, I don't know, five, nine, some number. And we did it by ward, so we ended up with a fairly large group of people. The group of people we met with were probably upwards of 100 people at times. I mean, we were really able to stimulate a lot of interest. We also sought endorsements. Once we had our product together, and this is largely a tribute, I think, to Carl Bukowski, who served as our spokesman for a lot of things. Carl kept the major players in the political process informed of what we were doing as we went along, so that when we were done, most people already had a good idea of what we had developed. And we were able to garner endorsements. There's a thing in the Flint Journal from that era where you will see almost every major political player in the Flint area endorsed what we were doing when it went on the ballot. There were exceptions. I believe some of the city unions in the end didn't actually endorse it. Finally, and I don't know what you do about this. It's a different era, and the newspaper only comes out four times a week now. But we had a Flint Journal reporter sitting in all of our meetings who religiously reported what we were doing. That kept the public informed, and it also provided that feedback loop I was talking about earlier. If it's very public what you're doing, if you're doing something that's going to get somebody mad, if it's in the paper, they're going to know about it and you're going to hear about it fairly quickly. But I don't know, I don't mean this to sound wrong, but you guys are anonymous. I don't see anything on TV, I don't see anything in the newspapers, and if that's the way the process is going to continue, there's going to be real problems selling it to the public in the end. I mean, I'm not saying they're not going to go along with what you've developed and respect it. I'm just saying that if you do that, if you do that kind of publicity along the way as you're developing it, you've got a smaller task at the end of the process. And I think that's about all I can really say about what our process was.
Questions?
No, I think you did gave us a good kind of a outline of what you guys did and a couple of new things that I want to suggest afterwards. So I think, John, you did a great job. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Mr. West, I would be curious, as you look back over the last 40 years and how the charter got kind of rolled out and used, the things that got placed in the charter, what are the things that you're proud of, and what are the things that that you think didn't work very well?
Well, the thing that I was proudest of when we were done is that we retained city council representatives in wards. That was a huge controversy with our group. Several people wanted them elected at large. I've always been a neighborhood advocate kind of guy. I'm still in the same position that I was back then. We needed a central figure to represent the entire city in the worst possible way, and I think we still need that. I mean, what I've just done to you here is tell you that I thought we did a great job, leave it alone. But in all honesty, that's exactly how I feel about it. I don't think that Flint's political problems are a result of our form of government. I think it has a lot more to do with the nature of the electorate. It has a lot to do with the nature of the problems that city government has faced. I mean, the major problem in Flint is Flint's broke. And it's been broke, and it means people got to make a lot of tough, ugly decisions in order to get anything done. And there's nothing closer to the electorate than a city councilman. And if somebody gets mad because their services are cut, it's real hard to stay in office as a city councilman. And I think a lot of the stuff that has gone on with respect to budgets has been a result of people ducking who's going to take responsibility for the ugly cuts that had to be made. I've lost a couple of friends that were on the city council, in fact, when Mayor Stanley was recalled. My quick and dirty question to them was, everybody's placing this squarely on Stanley's shoulders. And I'm going, charter says you guys write the budget. You approve the budget. If you don't approve the budget, there isn't a budget. So you've stood by the whole time this has gone on and allowed this to develop, and you're just as complicit as anybody else. Flint Journal finally did write an editorial to that effect, but way after the recall process had gotten started. So there's plenty of blame to go around with the failure to deal with budgetary issues. But I mean, I think those are the primary issue, and fiddling around with the form of government, I just can't imagine that changing the form of government is really going to do anything about that. Now, what I will also say about that topic is there are things you can do to strengthen the budgetary process. And you may want to take a look at those. I know everybody's mad about the board that the governor's appointed, but does New York City still have a board of auditors? At one time they did, and the mayor's budget had to be reviewed by that board of auditors to make sure that it wasn't funny money, and that the revenue projections were accurate, and that the spending made sense with respect to the revenues that were being anticipated. Okay. Well, maybe that's not an option, but there are things that I think can be done to the budgetary process that would keep it cleaner than it's been in some years. When you've got people inflating revenues that everybody's pretty sure isn't there, and then a council that won't say something about it, you end up in a lot of trouble over a period of time, and that's pretty much my analysis of what's happened here in Flint. You know, you had people passing blame back and forth, and nobody really wanted to bite the bullet and admit that city revenues had dried up and major cuts were going to be required. The other thing I would say is the charter calls for hiring an administrator, and if I made a mistake when I voted on things, then it was to not require that the city administrator have certain credentials. I felt strongly that the administrator should be somebody that the mayor could put his full faith and trust in, never dreaming that they would pick people for political reasons instead of competency reasons. And when you look at a couple of people that got named city administrator, you got to wonder what the logic of that was. So I think I would put some professional credentialing requirements in there for the city administrator.
Mr. West, you said from the beginning that your most critical issue that you worked on first was the form of mayor versus a council and city administrator. Were there any other critical issues that you saw at first?
Yes, I had 5 minutes, so I had to abbreviate a speech I put together for the Chamber of Commerce. And if you'll give me a second here, I'll... The council elections, whether they would be in wards or at large, was one. Whether there was even a discussion of whether people on the council should be and the mayor should be partisan or nonpartisan. The UAW at the time strongly expressed the opinion they would prefer that they be partisan officers. In the end, we didn't go along with their recommendation, but we spent quite a bit of time discussing it. Term length. At the time, the council, I think, had 2-year terms, and they were in the off year when they were elected. And right after we passed the charter, they were given the option by the legislature of making their terms 4 years, and they immediately did it. I don't necessarily have a problem with the longer terms as long as they're elected from a given set of boundaries in the city instead of at large. They are, I think, less responsive when it's a 4-year term, but then again, that might be a good thing and give people some ability to have some political courage when it comes to the ugly decisions that have to be made. And then there was a discussion of whether the election should be in the off year or at a regular election. Given the cost of elections these days, maybe that problem's kind of resolved itself, but the appointment of key officials. The mayor appoints some people by appointing them. That's the end of the story. In other cases, city council's got to approve whoever's appointed. I would point out to you, though, you've got to close a loophole with this one. We've had long-serving temporary department heads. They never become permanent, but they never go away, which essentially means that the mayor's naming them at that point. It really takes the council out of the equation. You might want to take a look at putting a time limit on how long a temporary individual can serve, which would force the issue and get the appointments back in front of the council for their approval. Civil service was discussed at length, and this was the one controversial area that got a lot of attention from the city unions. In the end, we ended up with the model that we have now. I believe the union appoints two, the management appoints two, and the four of them figure out who the other three are going to be. There's somebody sadly missing in that arrangement, in my view. Who represents the public interest? Management's interest is represented, the union's interests are represented, and then the two of them, if they happen to want to collude on something, are in a position to do it without any really independent public member being there to blow the whistle on what goes on. And I can tell you, in the years after I served on the Charter Commission, I saw some pretty funny things go on with the civil service system. It can be manipulated at length by people who understand how it's put together. I don't know that I bought the argument at the time that civil service is no longer needed because there are bargaining units to take care of the issues. I'm not sure that only the employees' interests are at stake here when we are involved in the hiring and firing process and the review of grievances. I think there's a role for a civil service commission that has some input to represent the public interest that may not be coterminal with what the union and the management wants. We also talked about independent boards and commissions. There was, in some people's opinion, then a plethora of the things, and they thought we ought to get rid of some of them. We had a long discussion about several of them. In the end, I don't think we, did we get rid of any? I don't think we did in the end. I think we decided to just leave the independent commissions there, but I don't know that they were as independent based on the way the appointed process worked. Pardon?
Parks
Commission. Oh, we did?
Yeah.
Okay.
The Parks Commission was made up of representative of the Board of Education, who went to the City Council.
Okay. So we did get rid of one. I should have known about that one, given what my wife does for a living. The ombudsman. The ombudsman was something that the minority community wanted in a very big way, and most of the pressure groups from the minority community wanted that ombudsman in place in the charter. There was already an existing ombudsman, but he didn't have charter status and he wasn't particularly independent. I spent a lot of time working on the ombudsman issue, and I had a little different spin. There's a Swedish model that this was borrowed from originally, and their ombudsman never behaved like our ombudsman did after they were appointed. The initial guy that got the job turned it into a complaint bureau, which in my opinion was counterproductive. The whole idea of rewriting the charter was you got a complaint, the buck stops on the mayor's desk. We ended up with an ombudsman running around the city taking 20,000 complaints a year. That just defeated the whole purpose of changing the model that we were operating under. Those complaints should have gone into the mayor's office first for resolution. And then if you could see conclusively that they hadn't been resolved, then they should have gone to the ombudsman. By reducing it to a complaint bureau, it tended to find itself in a really antagonistic position with the mayor constantly, particularly on issues of law enforcement, which I think was in keeping with the notion that the minority community had that something had to be done about police issues. I think it was probably a good office put in the charter to handle grievances that the existing bureaucracy wasn't handling. When Mr. Bankert took on the job, he took much more of that kind of an approach and ended up dealing with a lot fewer complaints. But if you read his reports that went into the city council, they dealt with really knotty problems that nobody else in the bureaucracy was dealing with effectively. And that's kind of the vision that I had. Instead, what happened is the ombudsman office exploded in terms of staff and personnel and people, ended up costing us, what, $250,000 a year, I think, before it was finally terminated. That was never my vision for what was supposed to happen with that office, and I don't think it was for most of the people on the Charter Commission at the time. By the time it got blown out to the size it was and the way it was behaving, several of the charter commissioners got together one day and expressed that opinion in a letter that was sent in. Financial control issues, debt limit issues, taxation limit issues were all discussed. They weren't the point of controversy that they have been here recently, but I would ask you to pay close attention to financial controls. One example that comes to mind is the city council was upset with the mayor and his budget, and they wanted to hire an auditor to take a look at the budget and find out if it made any sense. They got five votes together to hire an auditor, and the mayor vetoed it. And the mayor's veto stood because they had to get a sixth vote. So the council essentially lost its ability to hire an auditor to review what they thought was an errant mayoral budget. So you may want to take a look at how the auditor is hired and whether that veto should apply. At the time, the Rutherford administration said they did that because, you know, they were trying to hold down costs, and they didn't see the sense of hiring an auditor. Well, in as much as it was their budget being audited, that, you know, it's a suspect statement in my view.
But we could have just put it in the charter to have an audit as often as you want then, and that would just eliminate that.
Well, there are a number of mechanisms I think you can do to address that, but the key thing that I'm pointing out here is if it's subject to a mayoral veto, now you got to have a supermajority to hire an auditor, which I think, to my way of thinking, is an openness in government guy, is counterproductive. If the majority of the council thinks something's going wrong, they ought to be able to hire an auditor and find out whether it is in fact going wrong or not. They shouldn't have to turn around and get a 6 vote to override a mayoral veto. And that's caused difficulty over the years. I think, in fact, Carl ended up on the council when that debate was taking place.
We'll need to conclude, Mr. West.
Okay. Ethics issues, we took a look. It was during the middle of Watergate. We looked at ethics policy, and I don't think we ended up putting it in the charter. We decided at the time that it was just going to add to the controversy. Dan, that's... Right. Instead of putting the language in the charter, there was a simple sentence that said that there would be an ordinance governing ethics.
There was more detail. Ethics regarding this, ethics regarding this, ethics regarding this. There was five different things that made it being a question.
Yeah, and that was a compromise at the time. The original intent was to put a lot of that right in the charter.
Okay, we have one more question.
Quick question. What activities did your advisory committee undertake? How did you work with your advisory committee?
Well, they met on Saturdays, and they reviewed the language that we had developed, and they were then able to comment on what we developed along the way. I would add one other thing. We did actually have a group form at the end, independent of the government, to promote the charter as well. If you're going to get it passed, I would strongly suggest you find some civic-minded citizens that are going to support your process. You, of course, can't use government money to promote it, but we were able to use government money to print copies of it, though, to distribute to everybody in the end. So that was helpful.
Thank you so much, Mr. West.
Could I make a comment? I think we all enjoyed this. Would you be amenable to coming back at another date? I would like to invite him back at another date. Yeah.
You're welcome to attend any of our meetings. Our meetings are each second and fourth Thursday at 6:30 p.m. And we have committee meetings as well, and we can give you the dates of those as well. So we welcome your attendance.
Yeah.
All right. Do we have any public comment?
Yes.
Tom Donlin, I reside at 1117 South Franklin in the city of Flint. I'd like to talk about the Article 1. Section 1601 is the oath of office. I would direct your attention to the Michigan Constitution, Article 11, Section 1, also has an oath of office. The question is whether the oath of office provided in the state constitution precludes any contrary or additional oaths of office in the local charter. And we do have some discrepancy because we say pledge allegiance to the U.S. Constitution, the Michigan Constitution, and to the charter of the city of Flint. So the question is whether we could add the charter of the city of Flint. If the state constitution doesn't apply to local offices, there's no problem. But there is a question of whether it applies to both the state offices and the local offices. There's also a question about the boards that have been suspended because of the emergency manager. Among them are the local offices compensation commission. There's some argument that it's been abolished. Well, I'm a member of the local offices compensation commission. I've never heard that. I inquired about whether we would meet in the odd-numbered year, and I was told that no, because the emergency manager has precluded that, because the emergency manager is now setting salaries. But I don't know what happens now that the emergency manager is no longer there. No, there's been nothing communicated to me that this board that I was appointed to no longer exists. And the same would apply to the Civil Service Commission. Well, you had a speaker, Mr. Ed Parker. His belief is that the Civil Service Commission still exists. It's had a docket, but it has no funding. It has no funding by the virtue of the transfer of the powers to the city council. They didn't provide a budget for the Civil Service Commission. But now that the emergency manager is no longer there, I don't know what happens to it. I would believe that at least right now, if the council saw fit and could scrape up the money, or somehow, arguably, put the money involved, they could legally have the Civil Service Commission operating right now. Probably not. Probably they would say, no, there's just no money for it. So anyway, those are, to say that those things are defunct is not very helpful to a commission that has to look to the future, because the fact is that nothing's been done to abolish them. So I think tying your hands and say, oh, that's defunct, is not really very helpful. So anyway, those are my points. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge Donnellan. Mm-hmm. And we will take those remarks into consideration. And of course, the remarks from Mr. West as well. Thank you very much. Our next item on the agenda is our report. And first is the Finance Committee report.
Yes. Okay. You have before you a summary of our meeting from September the 22nd, this past Tuesday. We, as I stated in the summary, we are going ahead with our Saturday kickoff meeting at the University of Michigan. To get our public involved and to share with them what we've been up to for these months since we started. We're hoping for a successful event, that's for sure. And we're going to maintain the budget as discussed earlier in reference to this event. Grant funding was a major focus of our discussion on Tuesday also. We had in our discussion grant funding for legal consultant. In addition to utilizing the city law department, we wish to seek funding for an additional legal consultant, which would assist us in drafting and writing the charter. municipal governance consultant, a person that would provide information on the best or the best practices out there in academia and other cities similar to Flint. We had discussion about seeking funding for that also, and the public outreach committee. So sort of like a project manager, we're not sure what to call that person, but that person would possess current knowledge about holding forums and the ability to work within our time frame. We have 3 years to do this. We certainly don't want to take that long of a period, but work with the commission in making this a process occur timely. Administrative assistant person, provide ongoing secretarial and administrative support to the Charter Review Commission at its meetings of the whole and committee meetings, and work with that outreach project manager. All those were important discussions on Tuesday. And we wish to take these funding requests to the Mott Foundation. Ms. McGee was at the meeting, and she had stated we have a meeting coming up, and I have an updated sentence there that says it will be on October the 12th. Well, that's just around the corner. In preparation for that, I'd like to consider the development either through the person that we've been given by the administrative city administrator, Ms. Henderson's person to work with us in developing a concept paper. The second sheet of this document shows some bullet points I've come up with that says, you know, we need to have a concept paper when we meet with the Mott Foundation discussing these points I've pointed out here, along with, you know, what it is we want to do with the funding and what it is that they would be most interested in when they fund us. We have to share with them what's the importance of them funding us, what's their part in this process. We have to make that plain and simple. So the second page kind of addresses some of those bullet points, but I'd certainly like to, before October 12th, get together with the person from our administrative department. And I think you've got that set up, Ms. McGee, for us to do that.
I would like for the Finance Committee and the Public Outreach Committee to meet together to create this budget so that we will, because of course we know some of the needs, but we have to revise the budget that we have. So I would like for the two committees to meet together and anyone else who would like to join that committee and join in that meeting so that we can have a solid budget to present. And when we do meet with Kimberly Roberson and Ms. Alicia Cattusi, I'm sure Ms. Cattusi will be our program officer. And so we will be meeting October the 12th, myself, Commissioner Cherry, and Commissioner Wesley will be meeting at 9 a.m. at the Mott Foundation. So we want to have a solid base when we meet with them.
Yes. Although the next finance meeting committee meeting is scheduled for October 13th, I want everybody to be aware I'll be scheduling one prior to our meeting to take care of this business. And that's the report.
Thank you. Any questions for the finance committee? Okay. All right. Rules committee. Any report aside from the work that we'll be doing under old business?
I believe it'll all be taken care of under old business.
Thank you. Okay. Public Outreach Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to pass around a copy of the meeting summary. Jim's going to pass that around. So we had our meeting earlier this week. And our focus was on the September kickoff event. We have an updated internal agenda. Things are moving along for getting that ready. There's a couple of pieces. Thank you. There's a couple of pieces that I still need bios from individual charter commissioners. If you don't have one from to me today, I'm just going to write one and kind of put it in there for you. And we also need somebody else to help out at the sign-in table with Jim. Marcia, did you volunteer? Okay. Thank you.
I volunteer.
And John, Brian, and I are working on the presentation. Each of us have agreed to take a section of it. Thank you, both of you guys, for doing that. We're going to continue working through each of our edits over the next day or so. On Friday, Regina's going to be coming in the afternoon to, and she's available if John or Brian want to meet for the presentation piece, just to go over it, you know, one
more
time.
What time was that?
She's available anytime after around 1 on Friday.
Late afternoon would be best for me.
Yeah?
Me as well.
Okay. All right. We'll set something up over email.
Okay. Or just maybe after the meeting?
Or after the meeting. Sounds good. So the exercise is going to be one of the things we're going to be focusing a lot of our time on. And we did discuss it, but we didn't really come to a consensus at our meeting on which of the question here in green, what the last of the three questions that we're going to discuss, what qualities do you want to see in city government? Or something along what are some things that you want to see in the city charter? If anybody wants to give any feedback between now and later on this evening on that, over email or now, that'll be really helpful. I didn't want to go through everything at length because it is all in here and I think we're in good shape for the event. We also have a survey that we're going to be kicking off. The survey has only 8 questions. It's also attached. It's meant to be a way to get opinions and thoughts that people may have coming into the charter process. So it's structured that if perhaps you don't have, you know, an opinion at this time, that is okay. Or if you have something other than what's listed here to share, to, you know, you can write it in. And also to get some of the key concepts and concerns that people have around the city charter or that they'd like us to focus on. And then there's questions around some of those key departments that have been talked about within, that have been left out, such as the Ombudsman, Civil Service Commission, and Human Relations Commission, just to gain folks' opinions on those specific items, and also overall form of government and number of city council seats and configurations thereof. So really just to kind of see where everybody's at, we'll give folks an extra month to bring their feedback to us. So the survey will also be available online. If you have any, go ahead, John.
Yeah, on the council question, can mm-hmm. we put one in there that is by wards but with different number of wards?
Sure. Instead of B, could we just reword that?
Well, I think B is.
Or just add another one.
Yeah, I would add another one.
Okay.
Because I think B is something different.
Okay. Again, if there's anything else on that, email it to me tonight. Any thoughts? We're going to finalize these documents and get them printed tomorrow so that they'll be ready for the next day. We've had a lot of good, you know, outreach. We've tried. It's all here, all the different places we've gone, and we did get on Channel 12 News yesterday. We are still hoping to get somebody from the Flint Journal to come. I know somebody from East Village Magazine will be there as well. And we have been getting some RSVPs in through both Facebook and through the clerk's office.
Okay. Heidi, have you contacted Courier, if I said it right?
We did contact the Courier, and we tried to get an ad in there. We were not successful in doing
but
that.
But I'm saying as to be a guest at the meeting so they can write a piece mm-hmm. for the mm-hmm. following issue that whenever they are. I think it's, is it 2 papers now or mm-hmm. just that one?
It's just one.
Okay.
I can contact Reverend Harris.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Leo. Good idea.
And what about our TV coverage, television that's been done?
Well, we sent out the press release and we did get on Channel 12 News. If you have some specific contacts, anybody at any of those media outlets.
Okay, I'll make some calls again then.
Okay.
The reason I say that is because if we be lax about it, they'll be lax about it. We got to make it a big deal. Mm-hmm. And we want them to understand that when we, as a commissioner, call for some news coverage, I think they should be there. Because the coverage is, it's very important for the whole city to be knowing what we're doing, mm-hmm. and not come up later saying we don't know what the chartered people are doing.
Right.
So, all right, thank you.
Well, thanks for making some of those calls, Barry. Appreciate it. Anything else?
Well, I think everyone needs to know what time we're supposed to be there.
Oh.
We start at 10 a.m., and so we need to, of course, we can't walk in at 10 minutes to 10, so we need everybody there at least by 9.
9 o'clock, please. Yes.
And remember, everyone, that we are all assigned to tables, and we're assigned to tables, and we're to lead the group in the discussions based on how the facilitator works everything out. But we are to be at separate tables, so don't anybody combine together. We need to spread ourselves out so that we can be the lead at the table. Not to lead the discussion, but to make sure discussion happens and that, you know, those things where we make sure that everyone has a voice and so forth.
Great. If anybody has any questions on table facilitation, we can talk afterwards, and all of the questions and the layout of everything is in here. I think most of the commissioners were at the meeting, and I'm sure you guys all had a chance to look it over. So thank you very much for all of your help and support. Mm-hmm.
And we do have our charters copied, so participants will receive a copy.
Okay. Anything else? Nope.
All right, thank you. Any questions for the Public Outreach Committee? Okay. All right, thank you. Next is our rules of procedure. You received your final draft.
Madam Chair.
I'm sorry, did I skip some? Oh, I'm so sorry, I wrote it down too and still didn't do it. I'm so sorry, forgive me. Commissioner, on the Ford School proposal.
Yeah, so I just want to give everybody an update that I had contact with Professor Elizabeth Gerber this week, and she's sending out the opportunity this week to folks. So by the end of next week, we should know if we have anybody who's going to work with us. And she's wording the solicitation such that for the potential for it to go into the spring semester as well, so that would mean January through May. And in terms of details, talking about it, it would, if there are grad students who are interested in pursuing the independent study, it would be about 10 hours a week that they would be available to work on this work. So I'll have a better idea at the next meeting on if we got some folks.
And I'm hopeful that will happen, that we'll know soon, because I think that is an additional item to add to the proposal.
All right, I'll probably just, as soon as I find out, I'll send out an email to inform everybody.
Thank you. Okay. Next, Commissioner Richardson and the rules of procedure.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I believe that all of the commissioners were sent the latest final draft proposal for rules of procedure. Was sent out by email, and everybody was then distributed a copy of it this evening. This draft incorporates into it all of the edits that were suggested by the Municipal League, which were basically, for the most part, just edits editorial issues, and not much of any substance at all. What remains, Madam Chair, for the commission to decide has to do with rule number 33. So if I could draw everybody's attention to rule 33. It's on page 12.
I've got it on 13.
You got it on 13? Mm-hmm. I got it on 12. Okay.
Oh, I've got the edits showing.
Okay. The two areas of concern have to do with item number 5, public comment. And the issue that is before the group is, shall this be public comment on any charter issue that anybody has in mind, not specifically about items on the agenda. We had originally thought that it would be just public comments on the agenda items, but there's been a request that it be open for any comments about, I assume, charter issues. The second one has to do with the third reading of proposals, which would be item 10. And it has to do with where there we receive public comment. We have it now as public comment followed by final discussion by the commission, and then a final vote, and it's been proposed. And I believe the issue is on the table that we add in a item C, public comment on the third reading. Well, the last part would be that if the committee decides to place public comments on charter issues as item 5, there would not be a need for an item 14, which would have been public comments. That would have been repetitive. It just basically moves that up to the head of the agenda.
Can I add to that?
So.
Questions?
I just wanted to add, it was at my request that we move all of the public comment to item 5. I was recently at a city council meeting with the intent to share simply information on our charter kickoff meeting. And I had to wait till the very end of the meeting, and it was 3 hours into the meeting before I could talk, because it wasn't on an item on the agenda. And so thinking about if a member of the public wanted to come before us, I wouldn't want them to have to wait 3 hours to speak at the very end of our agenda. So I felt it was important that we move that up, all public comments, to the front.
And I believe that the proposal that's before the group does that.
Thank you.
So are we going to address each of these separately?
I believe that would be up to the chair.
Yes. Let's.
Well, if we say yes to number 5, then that should be the end of it. We won't have to go down to 14 if we all agree that we want to keep it at.
Oh, right. I meant as opposed to the public comment on third reading.
Right. We have two items. One is the public comment, and the other is a third reading and public comment.
Okay.
Okay. What is the position of the committee on the first item?
Well, the committee has not met. This was a proposal that came from the from the members of the Charter Commission at a Charter Commission meeting. Okay. And so it's it was a suggestion proposal that came out of that. And since that is the case, I think then that if there's some member of the Charter Commission which is would like to amend the proposal to include, to change item 5 to public comment on charter issues, that would be an appropriate motion at this point.
I would like to make that motion.
Which is?
Which is to change item 5 to public comment on charter issues and strike it from item 14, line 305.
I second that motion.
Any question?
Discussion? The only concern that I have is that that the comments that we receive are about the charter issues and not about issues which are not relevant to the work that we're doing.
And so I'll go back to Commissioner Panna's statement. You were concerned that, you know, that there may not be an opportunity for a person to address the commission during the actual meeting, waiting till the end. So do you agree? Or would you prefer that this the public comment would be on agenda items rather than on charter issues only?
I really wanted the public comment to be up front at the beginning of the meeting. And so I guess the question would be, if someone comes with us with non-charter issues, does that mean that we should not hear what they're saying?
Well, yes. According to this, it would be if it would be only on charter issues.
Yeah, we don't need to hear something else. That's one charter issue.
So I was really looking for specific, just to say public comment. I guess that would be more of a question for legal review. Is that,
No.
Mr. Roth, what do you think about?
I don't particularly think that that's
something
that's necessary for legal to review. I mean, it's your meeting. You can conduct it in the way that you wish, so long as it's open to the public and it follows the law. But
maybe I could ask this question. If a person addressed the commission, whatever the item is, it would be charter issues. Is that correct? If it's a question regarding our processes or anything that we're doing as a charter commission, it would still be charter issues. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
So. I think that's fine. It says it's self-explanatory, public comment on charter issues. If it has nothing to do with the charter, we're going to have to ask that person to hold his thoughts to a later date and time.
All right.
And that later date and time can be out in the community. He can ask that question out in the community.
All right.
Maybe a better way to state this would be just to have public comment and give people information. The chair could give information that we hope that comments are relevant to our work at the charter, and then...
No, it's public comment.
I just don't want to box us in. I'd rather be open-ended, but allow
think,
that our meetings...
I don't think it will box us in. Okay. I don't think it will box us in.
No?
Go ahead.
But I do want to box us in to issues around the charter, because that's the purpose of the meeting. That's
right.
Why we're here. That's what we can hear about. That's what we can respond to. But if it's an issue that has to do with the school board,
right,
we have no ability to respond or react to the pothole that's in the street.
Right.
Or the water bill.
Or whatever. It has. My preference is to be able to speak about it specifically as it relates to the charter and whether or not there's some celebration coming up sometime. That's nice to know, but... I think we want to keep ourselves focused on the business of that we've been elected to do, and that's the charter work.
Okay. Commissioner, are you satisfied? And
yeah, that's
okay.
Fine.
So you go back to your original
indeed
motion.
Same motion. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. All right.
Let's vote.
Let's vote. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Nays? Thank you. Vote. The motion is passed. Yes.
And then what's the other one?
It is just changing public comment on agenda items to public comments on charter issues.
And striking public comment from number 14.
Yeah, it is from item 5, rule 33, order of business, item 5, changing that to public comment on charter issues.
Let's move to the number 10, the third reading of proposals.
Let me see if I can explain this one. It has been proposed that we add another public comment time period in the third reading section. It would be the third reading, with the third reading of a proposal, the order of business would allow for public comment on the third reading. Anybody who had something to say about the particular item that we were working on in the charter, and we were coming to a final conclusion with it, would still have a chance to make a comment about it. B would be then a final discussion by commission members, and the proposal by a member of the commission was to add another public comment period on the third reading before a final vote.
Okay, I need to understand this a little bit better. The third reading, we would have, after the third reading, there would be a public comment on the third reading. And after that public comment, there'd be a final discussion. Now, C, there would then be another public comment?
That is the proposal.
Discussion.
No.
I believe some of the rationale behind that was that once the public had an opportunity to understand clearly where the commission was headed with their decision, then they could make any additional comments. But I can't speak completely for the commissioner who had that concern, as they are unable to speak to that. But yeah, I think that was the gist of it. So once the community knows, okay, the commission is going in this direction, they're definitely going to make that voice. All right, it's our last opportunity to speak.
Madam Chair, point of order. I believe this issue was tabled at a commission meeting. I believe it was our last meeting. Was it our last meeting?
It was.
Tabled at the last meeting. So I assume that there needs to be a way to bring it up off of the table for another vote, if I understand process correctly. And the person who can move it off of the table has to be a person who voted
for
the affirmative for it to begin with. I don't know. I'm looking at Mr. Roth to see where I'm getting lost. In my
was there an actual vote on it, or was it just?
Yes, we voted.
We did vote.
And we tabled.
I believe it would have to be somebody who voted in the negative. Someone who voted in the negative will have to bring it back up, because if you don't have someone from the negative moving, then it doesn't matter, because it's going to fail anyways, according to parliamentary procedure.
Okay, well, I voted in the negative the last time, so I move that we bring it off of the table, if that's an allowable parliamentary process. I'm not enough familiar with that detail to know if it's correct, but I'm going to take Mr. Larkin's word for it.
I don't think it was discussed. Looking at the minutes of the last meeting right here.
Then it was the meeting before.
Okay. Well, I don't have those in front of me.
Yeah. Attorney Roth is checking. Hopefully we'll have an answer in a moment. Correct. About the negative.
I think George wants to say something.
Mr. Roth states that he believes that is correct about the negative motion. So okay. Let's move on.
All right. Mm-hmm. So it's time to.
Is there any other discussion? Okay. On number.
So we have to vote.
Yes. On number 10.
Right.
the issue is C, so I need you to put that in.
So the I believe that the motion was to add in section 10C, public comment on third reading.
Mm-hmm. And everyone understands that's what we will be voting on?
And it's already on the table.
Right. Okay. There's no other discussion? All in favor?
I believe, do you need to do this? But I'd like it to be done by roll call, please.
All right, I understand.
Before we do that, I was the commissioner who wasn't present at the last one. So how was the motion formally stated? What is the motion specific exactly?
I don't know the exact words that were used on the motion, but it was to add a second public comment on third reading after the final discussion.
Right.
Okay.
Everyone, you understand that?
Yes.
Mr. Thank
you.
Okay. Thank you. All right, roll call, please.
No.
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 Madam Chair, having done that, at this point I would like to move the approval of the entire rules of procedure as amended this evening.
So
discussion.
Second.
I'm sorry. Discussion.
I would just say thank you, Jim, for keeping track of all the multiple copies of this and drafts and changes.
And I would like to thank the Rules Committee. It wasn't an easy job, and so you did a great job. Thank you very much. Any other discussion? Let's also go by roll call.
Can we just all in favor say aye?
Yes.
Ms. McGee?
Yes.
Mr. Medcalf?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Wesley?
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Okay. Motion passed. Thank you very much. Any additional business brought before the commission before we move on to new business?
I'd like to give David Roth an opportunity to share with us information on the Article 2 summaries.
I appreciate that. I have provided the summary tonight. I did notice that it looked like certain sections of it did not print quite well, so I will send an electronic version to you after this evening's meeting. I think the summary is pretty clear and relatively self-explanatory, but if you do have questions, feel free to email them to me, or of course you can call me in my office. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, new business, and it flows right along with the item that Commissioner Panoff had just talked about, discussion our charter provisions. Now that we have concluded our rules that we must work by, now we can start our actual work, and that is to review our city charter. And so I'm very grateful for Attorney Roth for the provisions. He's completed two thus far. So we have the first article that, you know, he has given us some information on. So I'm suggesting that everyone review the rules but also review the Article 1 so that we can start our discussion and really get some work done at the next meeting, because it's time to go to work. So our next meeting will be October 8th, and we will need to have lively discussion. And if anyone would like to start writing proposals, please do so. Well,
and actually, I was wondering, Mr. Roth, is it possible that you could draw up like a basic form that we could utilize to submit proposals to you that you could put into the proper legal language?
Yes. Yeah, that's definitely something I can, I'm sure I can come up with something. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
You could email that to all of the commissioners?
Yes.
Okay. So we want to start working. We want, from now on, all of our meetings need to be work-related regarding revising the charter. And so we need to make sure we have a clear understanding of the articles, read them, go over them, study them, along with the rules on how we're supposed to work, and also make sure you take a look at the provisions that Attorney Roth has provided for us.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
A lot of the rules call for us to work in a committee of the whole.
Yes.
On a lot of issues. Have you had a chance, probably not, to think through how we will do that process and get to the committee of the whole to begin to talk about issues? Because our process calls for a proposal to be submitted, and once submitted, then sent to the committee of the whole. So for us to go to work, what do we need to be submitted to get started?
And well, one of the things we did, we talked about the committee of the whole meetings, and it was, do you remember, we decided on specific meeting dates for commission meetings, and then for committee of the whole meetings. And so we need to go back to that and try to get that straightened out, and which are which. But yes, go ahead.
Can we talk about it right now?
Yes.
All right. So the next meeting would have been October 8th.
Mm-hmm.
And so from the discussion, I remember the first meeting of every month, which would be on the second Thursday, is the committee of the whole. And then the next one, which would be the fourth Thursday of the month, would be our commission meetings, one of these. The issue comes into play when we get close to Christmas.
Right. Cool.
So we wouldn't be able to meet on Thanksgiving, I would hope. I'm not going to be here. And we'd have to move those around. Maybe we move them to the third.
So then
Thursday.
Our meeting on the 8th, you're suggesting, would be
a committee of the whole meeting.
Committee of the whole meeting.
The 8th?
Mm-hmm.
Committee of the whole.
And can we do this in a committee room?
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, and the 22nd? Is that general meeting?
Can we also look at November?
Yes. So then November 12th would be committee of the whole.
Yep.
And the 26th would be general.
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's Thanksgiving.
I'll be eating my turkey.
So I would recommend we move it to the 19th, which would be 1 week earlier.
It's changed to what? 19th?
To change it to the 19th with everyone. It would be, that would mean we would be meeting two, the following week.
No problem.
Okay, that would be general.
Okay. Can we talk about December too?
Yes, because we said that we would definitely decide on our dates for December at this meeting.
Quick question before we line those. Well, two questions actually. So we're saying our next meeting is going to be a committee of the whole. According to how we have it structured in the rules, the committee of the whole, all they can do is open the what is it called?
General orders.
General orders. And so we won't have anything in the general orders because we put them in there in the committee meeting, in the commission meetings. So we have to have a full commission meeting in which we accept proposals and put them in the general orders to go to the committee of the whole. So that's the first part. So we need to get proposals in before, and we accept the proposals at the commission meeting.
Can we put the proposal right now? Because what we're doing is keep delaying and delaying.
That's fine. So, well, I guess there's three parts then. So that's one. The second part is then, I have to look back at the rules, even though we wrote them. Whether or not we have to do them separately, I think we wanted to do them separately because of the formal nature of the commission meeting, but if we don't have, so we could come in, accept them, and then go into the committee of the whole, and so on the 8th. So instead of going through and breaking down, because really what they were explaining to us in MML is the only reason we need our full commission meetings is when we're doing the formal actions.
Right.
But then for the bulk of the time, will be kind of, as we're hashing out ideas and thinking of them, it'll be committee of the whole. And so I don't know if we need to break it down the way we're doing it now, as opposed to figuring out based on how many proposals we have, how much work, and then setting up, really what we need to set up are when do we need commission meetings? So we need commission meetings to do formal actions. So we needed to put proposals in general orders, to send things to subsequent readings. Everything else, it seems like we need committee of the whole. So it seems like our standard meeting is kind of committee of the whole. And then when we need to do specific actions to move forward, then we need to make it a commission meeting.
Right.
If that makes any sense. Mm-hmm.
So we do have committee of the whole for the 8th.
And then we'll move it. We'll move it right then, just like you said. Because we're only going to do it on this occasion because of time.
Right.
Constraint.
Right.
But normally we'll go back to the way it normally should be.
He got it backwards. Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Larkin, I think maybe we've got it a little bit backwards.
Okay.
Because I understand the process of the rules is that a proposal has to come before the commission.
Correct.
And to be received by the commission. And it's automatically then sent to committee of the whole.
Right.
If we were to meet on the 8th as a total commission to begin with, in a formal setting, mm-hmm. and receive those proposals that could be then sent to the committee of the whole, we could, if there are no other items on the agenda, we could then move on to a committee of the whole meeting.
That's what I was trying to communicate.
I heard you say it the other way around.
No.
I apologize. I was trying to say exactly that.
And one thing, if we're not ready to actually give formal proposals ourselves, we could take current articles within the charter and submit those as proposals.
There you go.
So, yes, we're on the same page, Commissioner Richards.
Okay. All right. Let's move to December 10th. And that was the last meeting we had scheduled. And so, shall we have a meeting on December 17th?
Yeah.
I think we should, so that we can get two meetings in during the month of December.
I'm in favor of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And so, one suggestion, this is not laid out in our rules, but if we have proposals, we should probably send them to Mr. Roth first so he can look at them from make sure that they're worded properly for our intent. I'm just making the suggestion.
Is that a task that you would like to take on?
Before submitting the proposal. When the proposal is submitted, it goes to the clerk. Yeah.
I'm happy to review language for you so that while you're trying to draft it, but I think Mr. Larkin was saying that it is supposed to go to the clerk ultimately.
Right, yes.
As part of the procedure. But if there is language that you would like help drafting, I'm perfectly happy to, if you just email it to me or you mail it to me or whatever, I'm happy to take a look at it and be involved in that process.
Yeah.
For your instructions, of course.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. So I just really want to get some clarification for these next two meetings. So we do have Article 1 that we talked about we were going to begin discussion on. So I'd like us to begin discussion on Article 1 with the memorandum from David Roth, you know, as some supplemental material that we will have all again read and reviewed and be ready to discuss. I guess I wanted to just check with the other commissioners what we would have a regular commission meeting that would be abbreviated, followed by a committee of the whole where we could discuss that.
Right. Yes, that's correct.
Yes.
But we would have to have proposals also prepared, or couldn't we just have an open discussion?
It'd be open discussion.
By submitting
the articles.
We can get
yes,
it
we have the article.
We can get it on the agenda. We can get it.
Okay, so the question would be then, couldn't somebody just make a motion to submit all of the first section for review and discussion, or would that be not?
Well, some
you're
may,
doing it at that
we
meeting.
May have some may have proposals.
Proposal.
Okay.
And Commissioner Fanoff, I believe that was Commissioner Cherry's point. He was saying the same thing. You were saying that we could, for the point of getting the ball rolling, submit the existing sections of the charter as a proposal. So we'll have something in there in the general orders to open in the committee of the whole to address and change and do whatever.
Great. Yeah, and so Rule 45 deals with submitting proposals if you want to take a look, you know, just to take a look at it. So we might want to give the clerk a heads up that she should expect in the next 2 weeks to be getting some emails. Or at least 3 hours prior to our commission meeting.
please don't. Okay, anything else to come before the commission?
Just for a point of clarification, at our next meeting, could we have all of the dates for our meetings on a separate sheet?
Yes. All right.
Could our clerk just send an email as a copy of that so I have it correct? Y'all might do.
And you know, I guess I just want to be clear here. So every one of our committee of the whole meetings will actually be both a charter review committee meeting and then a committee of the whole, because we're going to put this out to the community. I want it to be accurate. That's why we wanted to get the calendar set. So.
Well, I think when we use language for the public, I don't think it's necessary to give information on whether it's a committee of the whole or whether it's a commission meeting, because I think it's confusing to the public to do that.
Just tell them it's a commissioner meeting and they're invited. They wouldn't know the difference anyway.
I believe the reason.
Larry, I'm right over here, sir.
I believe the reason for the ambiguity is, so if we go to our next committee of the whole meeting and we have 10 proposals or 10 pieces in there for Article 1, and we're going through them, and then we've decided we like some, we want to come back to others, the next meeting will be another committee of the whole where we're working through more of those. We won't go back until the commission meeting until we're ready to move things either to the next reading or we have new proposals that we want to bring into the general orders. So the purpose of the commission meetings as a whole are to move those pieces down through the process as we get to those places. So I don't know if we'll know where we'll, how quickly or how slowly we'll move through, but the public is open to either one. It's just a difference of like sitting here or sitting there.
I would like some clarification so that we could finish getting things ready for the kickoff meeting as far as which of these are committee of the whole and which ones are charter commission meetings. Because I also do feel there's other things that we're going to be discussing. The finance committee is going to be presenting some things regarding a proposal to the local foundations. I mean, we know we're going to need to talk about that. We are going to need to give reports of the other committees. Are those not going to be heard until a Charter Commission meeting that
no.
we
Right, so the Committee of the Whole is not going to be accepting committee reports.
Right, so that's what I'm saying.
And
so,
the that will be after after we meet with the foundation. That will be after the 8th. Our meeting will be on the 8th, and that will be after that. It's on the 12th. Should not be a lot of.
So we're going to have pretty much both meetings each time.
No, I think just
maybe
the one.
On the 8th.
There's a possibility, but.
So on the 22nd, we'll have our Charter Review Commission meeting. On the 12th of November, there'll be a Committee of the Whole meeting.
Yes.
Okay, so just the first one is going to be both.
Yes.
All right. Thank you. Sorry. Just wanted to get that cleared up.
Anything else? Do you have anything? Okay. Meeting's adjourned.